This is Mike from Wolves of Winter, hanging out in the Doom Tomb with Chris. Tune it low, play it slow. Check out our album on No Slip Records. We got some vinyl, we got CDs. Cassettes are sold out. Sorry you guys missed out on that one. But yeah, check us out. Wolves of Winter, Phoenix, Arizona.
Everyone, and welcome to the Doom Tomb podcast. My name is Chris. I am your host. Today on the podcast, we have most of the band members from the band Wizard, spelled W-I-Z-Z-E-R-D. The only person that wasn't involved was Wayne Randall. He was back at the ranch or back at the studios at Black Magic Studios in Kalispell, Montana. He was sorely missed, but we got a great interview. This is going to be a two-parter. We went over a whole bunch of stuff. We talked a little bit about Dungeons & Dragons, the inception of the band, how the band got started. When the band went out with Kal-El, they did also a track-by-track discussion of their release, their limited release that they were doing on tour, and even future releases and future ideas for other concepts regarding music and illustration, etc. So there's going to be a whole bunch to discuss and a whole bunch to go over. Now, as I'm talking here, I refilled my glass. I don't know if you can hear that right there. That's the ice in the glass. That's delicious. And this is Hammock Bay rum. It's so delightful. It's got some kind of cinnamon hint and some vanilla. And then inside, with it's mixed with a little cherry Dr. Pepper. So, yeah. So that's the drink of choice right now, as I'll take a little sip. Delicious. And I think it's time to get underway. So let's start it out. This is the interview with the band Wizard. I'm outside of Yucca Tap Room in Tempe, Arizona for a fucking incredible night. If you didn't come here, you just missed out on an incredible show. It was Duel. You had Stone Witch. You had Hoodoo Akil. And the people I am here with now, the band from Kalispell, Montana, the band Wizard. Gentlemen, how the hell are you?
Doing pretty damn good. Thanks for having us there, Chris.
Yeah, we really appreciate it, man.
Can you please just go around and introduce yourselves?
Hi there, folks. My name is Jalen Salazar. I play guitar and I sing here in Wizard.
I'm Lane. I play bass.
I'm Jamie. I play guitar.
My name's Sam. I play the drums.
Now, after the end of the night, who is officially the most wasted here?
It's definitely me, Sam Moore.
Okay. And you know what? And I think it's a good thing because he is the drummer, so he has a stool to sit down on if he needs.
That is true, and I think he kind of deserves it.
He also doesn't have a microphone on stage.
That is true. we keep that away from him for a reason.
He sits on a lot more things than just stools.
Well, as long as nobody pushes in his stool, we're okay.
Exactly. You know, as long as it has a seat, you know, he doesn't have the pole going up his ass, it's all right.
Yeah, well, I don't know. Do you have any light to shine on that, sir?
I'm the drummer. I make the bang bang. I make the crash crash. I'm the most important one in the band.
Well, well said. Well said. So let me ask you guys, how did you get started?
Well, we all kind of met up in high school. There's only two major schools in Kalispell. There's Flathead High School and Glacier High School. And Lane, Jamie, and Sam all went to Glacier while I went to Flathead, just because there's a highway that separates it that, you know, if you're on one side of the highway, you have to go to one school if you're on the other side. So we kind of were introduced by a mutual friend, me and Jamie were,
right,
back in, like, what was it, your sophomore year, my junior year, something like that. Was it even your freshman year? Yeah, it was freshman year. We were very, very young, like 16, 15 years old.
Right.
And we just started jamming together. And we didn't really start Wizard until a couple of years later. But we have been playing together for about 6 years now, collectively. We went through a couple drummers. And our mutual friend that was initially in the band left because he had some personal issues that we didn't want to deal with at the time. Right. We were all young and stupid. And, you know, when you're at that age and girls are a problem and you start thinking with your dick a little too much.
Uh-huh. So, it could be the downfall of exactly. many people.
But in that process, we found Sam, and Sam was like the best drummer we had ever seen. You know what made him the best drummer that we had ever seen was that he could play a 4-4 beat continuously for longer than 30 seconds. So we were pretty fucking happy with that. And we started practicing a bit. We mostly did covers just because, you know, we were a young band. We didn't know what we wanted to do. We initially started out as kind of a thrash band.
Right.
And then we met Lane at a high school talent show over at their high school in Glacier. And we were playing a cover of War Pigs. And there was only me, Jamie, and Sam. So it was two guitars and a drummer, but no bassist. So Lane comes up to us right after. He's like, "Hey, where's your guys' bassist?" And we said, "Oh, we don't have one." He was like, "Oh, fuck, I'll do it."
Yeah, why not?
And then it was like,
we started out, Jalen and I knew each other from the orchestras because we would always do out-of-town trips and stuff, and they would have the cross-school mingling type thing, you know. And one of my other friends had actually said, "Hey, I've got some friends playing in this talent show, you should come watch them do this audition with me." And her name was Christina, and she kind of basically introduced me into it. And I asked them if they needed a bass player, and they were kind of like, "Yeah." So then on my birthday, my dad did a little bit of research and bought me my first bass guitar. And
what kind was it?
It's an Ibanez ATK, and I will never get rid of that bass. That thing is fucking... It's a great guitar. But
It's the one you started with, and yeah. How can you ever give that up, really?
Really? Yeah, seriously. I mean, Jamie still has... Do you still have that... is it a Jackson?
Yeah, I still have that guitar. It was the first one I bought that was not made of plastic and bought at Target.
But so we go in there and we just jammed around a little bit, and it was like this really stressful thing. It's like, "Oh man, I wonder if I'm gonna make it into this band," and like played a couple shitty notes, and they were like, "Oh dude, we should hang out." And I remember like one of the first times we had hung out, I think it was Sam and it might have just been everybody was in Sam's mom's car, I'm pretty sure. They were playing something off of the Fallout soundtrack, so something really jazzy, soulful.
Right.
40s-esque. Yeah, 40s music, and everybody's just headbanging super hard. And so when I walk up and open the door, and it's like, do like some just, you know, stand-up bass line.
Wow.
But it was... very fast friends, for sure.
So basically, a long story short, we met in high school.
Met in high school, yeah.
And then something magical happened on October 25th of 2014. And
what was that?
We had a very special trip.
Okay, go ahead.
And we decided, I remember looking at Sam, it was about, it was around 3:30 in the morning.
Right.
We're just hanging out, and I look over at Sam, and I'm like, "Hey, we don't have a band name that really sticks." So I looked them dead in the eyes. I'm like, "Dude, what if we just named ourselves Wizard, but instead of an A, it's an E?" And then we didn't say anything. And then the next morning, Sam added the second Z to make it sort of symmetrical for, you know, make it look cool for logos and shit.
Sure.
And it just stuck. We all just had like a silent consensus that Wizard was the band name.
It's perfect. It fits. It just fits. Now, this is the second time I've seen your live show, And both times, man, it's just nonstop. It's nonstop thunder. But I do have to point one or a few things out about seeing you on stage. First of all, I think you're some of the most dapper gentlemen on stage.
We definitely try. The best dressed in all the West, right?
You know, they say that the shoes make the man, which is why I have the best shoes.
You really do. They are outstanding. But, I mean, seriously, you guys, you all have button-down shirts, and it's like, and then you come out, and you, I didn't know what to, like, okay, here's a perfect example. Like, a year ago, I saw you all, and I didn't know who was in the band yet, and I actually saw you walking through the crowd, and I'm like, that's interesting. I don't know, is he on the right show? I'm not really sure. But then you got on stage and fucking tore it up. So it's like, you know, it doesn't matter what you wear. You could not wear anything. I mean, it would be a hell of a different show.
Just completely naked.
Yeah.
Yeah, we kind of get that reaction a little bit. You know, it's a little bit different for, you know, seeing some heavy doom bands wearing, like, button-up shirts and ties and all that shit.
Right.
We think it's professional.
I mean, we see, like, a ton of doom bands that just, like, go out and wear a T-shirt and jeans, and that's badass, and that's rock and roll and everything, but we wanted to do something that's just, like, a little bit different, and we thought that nobody really dressed up in bell-bottoms and button-up shirts for, like, every show.
Right.
So we're like, and why not just do that?
It does help you stand out. I mean, the guys in, is it Sun Voyager? Is that the band I'm thinking of? They all wear these, like, almost like cowboy shirts.
Oh, really?
Sorts, with like heavy floral, and they all wear the same thing, and you know, and it's their look. They created their niche, and everybody knows when you see that you're going to see Sun Voyager.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, I think it's a great idea. Now I also saw that there was a dragon on stage.
Yes.
Now what is the purpose of the dragon?
So you have the second album.
Yes,
the second album sort of tells the story. Or tells a story within itself. Both Doomchild and Wizard, the self-titled, are concept albums. So each of us, Randall isn't here with us, but he is the fifth member. So we have the five emblems on the front.
Right.
It is the Wizard, spelt normal, said stupid, because we have to kind of, you know, differentiate that.
We spell one stupid.
Exactly. We say one stupid, we spell one stupid. So we have the Wizard, which is Jamie. The Phoenix, which is Sam.
Right.
We have the Warrior, which is Lane. The Wraith, which is Randall, who is not with us. He's back home with the studio, and we'll talk more about that later.
Yeah.
But I am the Dragon, and that little dragon I've had since my senior year of high school, and we all normally carry, like, totems with us.
Right.
So Lane has a little Warrior, Jamie has a little Wizard, Sam used to have a little Phoenix, but it got stolen. Where did it get stolen at?
Hell, I don't remember. Somebody stole it.
Yeah, somebody just took it. Somebody was like...
Pacifica, Winner's Tavern.
Yeah, it was at Pacifica. Yeah.
Yeah, Def bought me another one, though.
But yeah, we have like all these little totems to represent our characters in this story.
Sure.
It's kind of like a, you know, like a D&D campaign. We're all a bunch of nerds.
All right.
So,
do you play?
A little. Lane and I, mostly, more so than the other two.
A lot more than anybody.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that is true. We really want to start a campaign, but the problem is finding the time to do it.
Okay, okay.
We spend all our time jamming and practicing, so...
We can't sit down and play a game of D&D for 2 hours.
No, I can imagine it. Now, let me ask you something. Tell me more about this D&D. I've seen it. I saw it when I was a kid, and it's been going on for years and years. So what is the appeal to you? What do you like about it?
The fantasy, the role-playing aspect, the immersing yourself in a different world.
Right.
You know, creating a story.
Now, if you can add to that, there's people playing, and then there's the head person.
The DM.
And Dungeon Master, okay. And that person decides the fate of other people, or how does that work?
It's kind of depending on... what you're playing, because there's a lot of presets for D&D, like they'll put out books or whatever, or, you know, whatever system you're using, because there's a lot more than just Dungeons and Dragons, and it's all based off of what kind of dice you're using, or
right,
how detailed the world is with, well, rule set wise and stuff like that. But could you give me the question one more time?
I was just curious as to, like, for the Dungeon Master, that's the person that dictates the majority of the game and where people are going or not going.
And it's definitely, like, each position is difficult, being a player character and also being the dungeon master in its own unique way.
Right.
Like, as being the dungeon master, you kind of make decisions like, someone says, hey, I want to do this thing that's kind of outside the rule set. And then you, as the dungeon master or the game master or whatever, kind of have this, basically a say. It's almost like making house rules for Yahtzee or something like
right,
that.
Right.
You know? And so it's very interesting because you have this game that somebody created, but it's very just loose, so you can just make your own fun with it, really.
Right.
And kind of have your own set. And sometimes entire campaigns can be defined by how well your dungeon master directs the campaign, you know?
So. Do you usually stay with the same people, or do you switch up? Is there, like, maybe a forum where you get to find another player?
Well, me personally, I probably play the most because I have a lot of online friends, and
right.
We use this system called Roll20. It's basically just a grid that you can upload maps onto, and we've had pretty much the same three dungeon masters. We kind of rotate through them, but I mean, you know, it's just kind of.
You just grab whoever's around sometimes and...
Yeah, pretty much. My dad kind of started me off with it, and that's really the only time I've ever actually sat around a table with people to play with people who are physically there.
Okay.
So.
All right.
But hopefully we're going to do that here soon.
Yes.
Good.
A lot of our story for the concept of the albums kind of comes from... like an idea of a comic book, like Heavy Metal.
Okay, yeah.
And there's a lot of influence from the comic book Heavy Metal.
Right.
And we're hoping to make a comic book and kind of a story going along with characters we've made for each of us.
Right.
And our third album, which our second isn't out yet, but
we've begun
writing.
Well,
it's
our
kind
third
of one. Around somewhere. I think I might have one right, right here.
We kind of plan on making our third album a little bit of a comic book story.
Right.
Very influenced by Heavy Metal. And
have you seen the stuff that David Paul Seymour has been doing, the comic that he's been creating?
Yeah.
I mean, it's just incredible.
Yeah, I've seen a little bit about it. It's like taking a while in production, but
yeah.
Yeah, no, I'm pretty excited to see that. It's like the whole like Doom comic.
Yeah,
and then they have aren't they doing like an animated with that too?
Yes, something? They are.
Yeah, and a whole bunch of people are doing tracks for it. I've been seeing that shit for a really long time. I'm really excited for that.
Because I feel like every Stoner Doom show, whatever Sludge show I go to, there's always one person. I think this might even be a David Paul Seymour.
I actually think that is.
I think it is. Yeah, that's from Forming the Void,
yeah,
of course.
Forming the Void.
And gosh, man, what an incredible artist. And
for sure.
Unfortunately, whatever, he comes up about every podcast that we talk about him a little bit. And
well,
someday
we need to get some art from him.
Yeah. Yeah. So, all right. So on your forearm, I see a tattoo. Now, is that a Kal-El?
You bet your ass it's a Kal-El tattoo.
Now, you guys went out on tour with them,
yes,
right?
Yes, we did.
Tell me about the tour.
How was it? Quite possibly the best tour I've ever been on in my life.
Right.
but that's just personal for me because I had been in contact with Kal-El for about a year and a half beforehand. Just a big fan. One day, Astra Demita came up on, I think, like 666 Mr. Doom or somebody had it up, or maybe it was even Mr. Stone Believer had it up on YouTube. And I was just going, I was just browsing through. I was like, oh, okay, let's find some new shit.
Right.
I saw the album cover for, it wasn't Astra Demita, it was Echosphere. Astra Demita just came out. So it was Echosphere, and it's got that, like, really hot space babe, like, right in front of, like, this big old space backdrop. And I was like, what the fuck is this? So I click on that. Heard the first notes of Astrogate, and I was immediately hooked. So I'm like finding out where these guys are from, find out they're from Stavanger, Norway, and I started following them on Facebook, and they were posting all this stuff about merch that they had and merch that they only had locally, and I was like, you know, I commented and like said some shit, and I was like, you know, I really wish I was out there. I'd love to get some. And they were like, where are you from?
Mm-hmm.
I'm from the USA. I live in Montana. Oh, really? Okay, we'll send one out to you.
Nice.
How much? Oh, we'll give it to you for free.
Really?
Okay, so I get this beanie. I get this, like, little care package, and I still have the packaging that has, like, all their stickers a bunch of stuff from Norway on it that was just a beanie and, like, a pack of stickers and a pin.
That's
and I
awesome.
Have that pin on my battle vest, and it has not left. Oh, and a patch, too.
That
so I have
awesome.
All that shit, and it has not left. It has not left my vicinity because I absolutely love this band. So eventually, Stola, their vocalist, hit me up on Facebook and was messaging me, and he said, "Hey, do you know anybody in the East Coast that would be able to set us up for a tour?"
Right.
And we're from the West, so we really didn't know anybody.
Sure.
I asked a friend of ours, Tony Reed from Moss Generator, mm-hmm. if he knew anybody or if he knew like. People on the East Coast, and he said, "Well, we don't really tour there often, so I can't really help you out." So I messaged him back and I say, "Yeah, well, we really don't know anybody in the East Coast here. I really can't help you out, but if you want to do something on the West, we can definitely help you there because we have some connections."
Mm-hmm.
And they're like, "Okay." So we want to do a tour in the U.S.
Okay.
Initially, they said they only wanted to do like 3 days.
Right.
And we were like, okay. And they said there are a couple stipulations. And, they, you know, regular stipulations like food and housing mm-hmm. and transportation and stuff like that. And backline. And they said, the one big stipulation, though, is that your band has to tour with us.
No shit.
I freaked out.
Yeah.
I screamed like a little schoolgirl. I'm not kidding. And so Jamie started setting that stuff up. Do you want to talk about that for a minute? Because I don't know how that process went.
Yeah, I mean, we had already done a tour of the West Coast, so booking the West Coast wasn't, like, that difficult, so we just kind of set up some shows. We were able to talk them up to doing, like, about a week instead of just 3 days. And so we did 7 shows over 8 days.
Right.
Just down and up the West Coast, like Seattle, Eugene, a few California dates as far as L.A. at the Viper Room, and then back up and ended it in Portland. And it was just such a fucking fun time to just... piling with people that were so like-minded but from such a different background than you into 2 cars and just kind of like do it for the week and just see what happens. And it ended up being a lot of good shows and a lot of fun times and making really, really good friends.
Really good friends. It was very, very difficult to leave them at the very end of the tour, like tears in our eyes.
Well, I can tell you got a permanent...
I had to. Yeah. No, yeah. It was funny. So we went there. And Jamie and I, did we leave a day earlier than everybody else to go and meet them and, like, go get their hotel and all that business? So we left early, and we met them at a bar, which was about, like, a block away from where they were supposed to be staying.
Right.
It was just in this, like, separate, another hotel. This other hotel had a bar in it. I'm like, fuck it. They had to go get something to drink. Those guys can drink.
Right.
Like, let me tell you, those guys can drink. But so Jamie and I go there, and their vocalist has the same tattoo, but it's a little different
mm-hmm.
on his wrist. And I see it, and I'm like, I see that fucking kick-ass Kal-El tattoo you got. And he's like, yeah. I'm like, I'm going to be getting one as soon as I get home. He's like, you're full of shit. I bet you won't do it. And I was like, bet, motherfucker. And I did it. And I the whole time I'm getting it, I'm sending them videos. But, yeah, so we get there, and they're just piling beer after beer on us, and we just instantly made a really heavy connection with Stola and Bjorn, their vocalist and drummer.
Right.
It was super cool. Yeah.
So what if they speak Norwegian then?
Yeah.
So what did you learn in Norwegian?
I learned quite a bit. On my tattoo, it says Godolt, which literally translates to good everything.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not typically something they say in Norway. It's more of a Kal-El saying.
Right.
And it's kind of like they're all as well. They're okay. You know, okay. Everything is going to be all right.
Okay.
All that shit. But they learned like, what was it? Visma Patanas? Is that what it was?
Show me your tits.
Show me your tits. I learned a little bit of Norsk. I've been kind of teaching myself a little just because I was gearing up to head over to Norway, but some plans changed, so I'm not going to be going there now, but I'm still learning it.
There you
but
go.
They taught us just a couple things like tuft, which is means cool, and like skål, you know, the really
skål. Yes.
Skål. We say that a lot. Whenever we drink, we say skål just because of them.
I just saw the band Tear.
Tear.
About a month or so ago, and yeah, they said, you know, skål.
Skål.
And I'm like, okay.
Cheers.
Yeah, right on. It works for me. So okay, so the last festival you played was it Electric Funeral?
It was Electric Funeral.
And talk to me a little bit about that. What happened there? Well, or you know what? Better question.
We all know of the bands that everybody goes to see. That's a fucking given. Anybody that lit your pants on fire that like you just you didn't hear of before, and you're like, now I gotta follow them.
Keef Duster?
Yeah, I was going to say Keef Duster was a band that I had never heard of.
Okay.
And they opened the entire festival, like first band on the first day. And they played in the Mutiny Cafe, which is a bookstore slash pinball shop slash gaming shop slash comic shop slash cafe slash record store slash it goes on and on. But
it's a Renaissance store.
They just move a couple shelves and throw up a stage in the back, right. On the floor, just set up on the floor. They have some lights and a little sound system, and it sounded fucking great. And Keef Duster just opened it and really took me by surprise, and I think all of us.
Okay.
It was pretty rad. They had a pretty, was it a five-piece? They had a guy playing, was it slide guitar? Yeah, dude was playing slide guitar, running it through a shitload of effects, and he would, like, switch off and play a normal guitar, and they had another guitarist, and they had their bassist and a drummer, and this, like, tiny, tiny little, like, chick vocalist.
Really?
Fucking powerful voice, though.
Yeah.
My God, I loved it. Their first song, the only lyrics I could get out of it, it was probably because I was so goddamn stoned,
right.
Was Hashishian.
Hashishian.
And the whole time I'm just like, dude, yeah, they get it. They listen to fucking Sleep. Right,
with the Hashishians and the Marijuana-ots.
And the Marijuana-ots, all that good shit. Iommi. And Praise Iommi, always Praise Iommi.
But you have a similar song. And how do you, is it Druggernaut? Yeah,
Druggernaut. So in the concept of the story, I'll try to keep it short. Druggernaut is essentially the start of the world.
Okay.
It is the creation of Earth itself.
Sure.
It is a golem made of stone, smoke, and drug.
Mm-hmm.
So this giant asteroid being crashes into this mass and creates Earth, and that's what Druggernaut's about. So it's the whole process of that. But yeah, that's kind of like that and Desert are kind of our homages to Dope Smoker, because
sure.
Dope Smoker's super influential, and Sleep itself is just super influential.
The last time you came through here, you said that. You're like, I can't believe that the previous time that you were through, you didn't play Desert.
Yeah.
And then you threw it down, and it just destroyed. It was fantastic.
Yeah, we decided not to play it this time around, just because we wanted to squeeze a little bit more in, kind of get some more of the newer stuff. You know, we played, I don't think... We did have Doom Machine in our repertoire last year.
Yeah.
But I don't know if we played it or not.
I don't remember it.
Yeah. But no, we wanted to squeeze just a couple more just because Desert is so damn long.
Yeah,
but
yeah.
It's a fucking great track, and we love to play it just because it's a good break, and it's a good trip for people, and especially if people can, you know, smoke beforehand or, you know, have a fucking nice solid beer to drink. You know, it's always a fucking good track to play live.
Absolutely. Now, since we're talking about some of the tracks, would you mind if I went through some and maybe if you have like a one sentence or a couple words about it? Doesn't have to be, you know, too lengthy about the tracks here.
We'll try not to ramble.
Let's see. We can go with Doomchild. Let's start with that.
So... Doomchild is the story of a nameless boy. He is a bringer of storms and disasters, so he gets sent out. So Doomchild itself is a concept album, and inside the gatefold is the poem that I wrote in high school that is all about the Doomchild. So it tells the whole story in there. But Doomchild is essentially the kickoff track. It's him being cast out into the desert, so everything follows suit.
Okay.
Yeah.
So then he goes into the desert, so that would be Desert.
With Desert. Desert is, I think, six or seven movements. It's seven movements. So we have The Journey, which is like the main riff that all the fucking C's, because I can only play C. I'm not very creative. But it is him, and every time it goes into a new riff, it's him crashing into the sands and passing out and having a vision. So the first vision is about the Druggernaut, the beginning of the world.
Mm-hmm.
The second vision is the spirit of the desert. And the third vision is the omniscient, the Omni, the essentially the God of this earth, of this world that we've created. But we haven't really, you know, delved into that too much. He's kind of just like an overseer. He doesn't really do a whole lot.
Is that where you go into Forest?
In Forest. So in Forest, he passes out. But in desert, at the very end is when he crashes and passes out in the desert. And he wakes up in the forest, but he doesn't know how he got there. In our story, we don't say it very bluntly because it's obviously we can't really, you know, say it in music.
Yeah.
But the spirits of the totems mm-hmm. are what carry him to safety. But nowhere is really safe for him because wherever he goes, disaster is sure to follow. And in forest, he wakes up and he knows what's going to happen, which is something fucking shitty.
Right.
And what happens is the forest starts on fire.
Okay.
It burns down. It's also kind of like a little bit of an homage to the forest fires we have back home.
Sure.
Which are really bad. And we've had some pretty bad ones in the past, like, 3 years where even last year was terrible. It's all just smoke and smog, and you can't go outside for very long. It's really? Like raining ash. Yeah, it's bad. It gets really bad.
I know there was bad in California. Yep. I had no idea.
Yeah, the whole western United States was on fire, us included.
Jeez. So, and that goes into ocean.
Ocean is him reaching the end of the forest and swimming out. So the whole thing is him running away from something he can't run away from.
Mm-hmm.
And in ocean, even more bullshit happens. Typhoons, tsunamis, literally everything that could happen that is terrible happens. And at the very end, all of time stops. And that's when we go into sky.
Mm-hmm.
And in sky, he is brought up into the heavens by the Omni to become this god, this creator of all natural disasters on this earth. So he is the one that is making the fires happen, that is making the tornadoes happen, the hurricanes. Okay. Every natural disaster isn't natural. It's caused by a higher being.
So, okay, so that was really interesting. I like that a lot. Was this a concept that you came up with in high school?
Yeah, I had a poetry class, and I was, we had written Forest. Forest was the very first track that we had ever written as Wizard. And I had the lyrics were really simple for that, and I decided to devise a little bit of a read before we played it the first time, which was our senior year at Flathead High School at the talent show, because that's what we could play when you live in small town Montana.
Sure.
When you're like 17, 18, you can't go play bars.
Exactly.
So, so we were playing a high school talent show, and at the very beginning, I read a little bit of the poem, which is the section of the forest.
Mm-hmm.
And I decided, you know, I think we can tell the whole concept with what we've written, because it's all essentially elemental stuff that all fit together on one singular concept.
Okay.
So I decided, in poetry class, we had a lot of free writes, and I actually submitted that and another poem to be published. And my other one got published, not Doomchild. I was kind of pissed off because the other one was just mocking poetry.
Sure, sure.
And they were like, oh my God, I really like this.
That's
like,
really good.
Fuck. Come on. But it just came to me. I just wrote it all down.
Wow.
We all dug it, so we decided to keep it.
You all worked with it, yeah.
A lot of our concept and stuff kind of comes from these classical four elements, and
Like fire, wind?
Fire, wind, earth, and air,
yeah.
And the fifth being spirit or consciousness, and a lot of this kind of hermetic influence, a lot of tarot, stuff like that. We kind of try to incorporate some of the occult ideas into our work.
Mm-hmm.
'Cause a lot of symbolic meaning comes from these elemental things that are just part of human consciousness. Every story that's ever been told kind of has common themes.
Right.
And so we kind of try to take influence from things that no matter where you're from, these stories could relate to you in some way. You understand what it means when a forest fire happens,
yeah.
Or when a hurricane goes on. These are things that are relatable cross-culturally, and we try to write things that come from kind of the human subconscious and things that are universal between people.
Awesome. Well, okay, so with that said, I want to take a quick break, and as we do, what song would you like to have played off of that release that best encapsulates it?
Shit, might as well play Desert.
Play Desert?
Desert is definitely the one that that is the crown of that album.
Okay, we'll be back in just a minute. Take a break. I think we're going to play one of the tracks. One of the tracks actually that Jalen suggested, and that would be the track Desert. If you haven't heard it yet, it's kind of a long song, so I want you to kick back, relax, just enjoy the music, and we'll get right back to the interview after this. Let's check this out. This, from Jalen's request, is Desert. Thank you. we lost a member for a little bit. I think Sam needs to wet his whistle a little bit, get a little more taste of the suds. So I think we'll... Now, okay, so we talked about the first release. Now, you... Explain what you did with this, because I purchased the new release, or the... What is it? You officially remastered it?
It's a remaster, yes.
Okay, did you add anything...
Well, oh, here. Yeah, I'll give it to Jamie.
More than anything, it's like a tour exclusive CD. We did a little bit of remastering on it, but we want to do more work on it before we would say, like, press it to a record or something like that.
Right.
So we it sounded like a demo to us before, so we kind of changed it up, and I think it sounds a good lot better now, but there's still, like, some other things that need to be done and some other things that we might want to do with it or, like, mess around with different techniques. Try and get a little bit different sound out of it before we go forward. But we wanted something to sell on tour, and the only thing that we really had was where it was with a remaster, and so we decided to just make like 50 CDs
and I think that's
throw them
great
out there. Like
it just shows to people, go to the fucking show. If you don't go to the show, you don't get this.
Exactly.
And like, what was this? How many did you make of these? This one?
100-ish, I think.
Okay, I got one of these last year. And do you have any more, or they're kind of gone, right?
They're gone as fuck.
So I was super jazzed to grab this when I could. And you said it last year, like, this was an on-tour thing. This is the only time we're doing it. And that goes for everything, though. It doesn't matter. Like, some people bring out their special splatter-colored vinyl on tour. Pick it up, or you're not going to get it.
Exactly.
I mean, it's that simple. And I think that is a brilliant idea as far as marketing, to say, you want it, you got to come over, you got to check us out.
And of course, we feel bad about all the people that don't live in the cities that we hit on tour that would want it. But
well, maybe,
they will eventually get a product that we all feel is better.
You know what?
You know?
And maybe if those people don't come, or those people aren't in the area that you're touring, you save a few. Just a few. And... You know, honor me with a story of why you didn't come to my show. And then, maybe, just maybe, I'll sell you the CD.
Tell me why you chose to live on the East Coast, okay?
Oh, Christ, it's so goddamn cold over there, man. I mean, I was in Florida. I used to live in New York, and I don't understand what happened. Like, I don't know. You're all in Kalispell, right?
Yeah, if you want to talk about it getting fucking cold,
yeah, now,
you can talk to us about that.
All right, let me... I got to ask, because I used to do this as a kid and as a teenager in early 20s, where I had a mailbox that was up the road from my house, and I would walk outside in the snow barefoot, and I would walk up, and I would get the mail, and I would come back. My feet were numb.
Yes.
They were gone.
Yeah, it
but I did it all the time. Now, if it's under like 75, it's like I got like chills.
It's amazing because everything around here is so cold inside.
It is freezing. I was at a show. You know, we were talking earlier about green Jell-O, and I remember being at this green Jell-O show. And it was over in Phoenix, and it was so fucking cold in that place. My hands were numb. I actually went in the car to put on the heat in Arizona so I could warm up. It was so cold in that place. It wasn't that cold in here tonight.
No. It was very, very spicy. Intense and spicy on the stage, I would say.
Do you find that a lot at some venues, or...?
It really depends on so many things. It's like really hit and miss. Sometimes the venue is like well AC'd or in a place where it doesn't need like all that AC. Like we play a venue in Big Sky all the time. Like last year we went on tour and it was like June and we came here and we came to all these places that were like 100 plus and we played Salt Lake City and it was like 100 degrees that day. Yeah. And as we drove to Big Sky, when we got there and started unloading gear, it was 50 degrees.
Yeah. Wow.
And it felt fucking amazing. But the venue was very temperate, which was good. But around here tonight, it was way too hot.
There you go.
Well, I mean, after every show, it kind of doesn't really matter what the temperature is. We're just going to be sweaty as fuck by the end of the show.
Oh, absolutely.
We just go ham.
Sweaty and yet dapper. Don't forget
yes,
dapper.
Yes.
Now, let's take a quick sidestep here. I have a gentleman that's kind of huddled over the touring... truck here. How are you doing?
You okay?
I'm doing pretty good.
Did you grab another beer?
Yes, I did.
And what was the beer of choice?
Kilt Lifter.
Highly recommended.
It's good stuff.
Yeah. Is that, is that a red? Is it a?
I'm not really
Scotch
sure.
Scotch ale?
I'm pretty sure. Because it was like... It was like made by Moylands, some company called Moylands, but I think some other person was making Kilt Lifter, so they had to change the name. So I'm not sure what Kilt Lifter is now, because I don't know what the other company that made the original, quote unquote, original Kilt Lifter was, but I'm pretty sure it's a Scotch ale.
I know what it is.
Yeah.
It's good beer.
It's good beer.
That's what
I don't.
From Montana, we know about good beer.
Personally, I just can't imagine wanting to lift anybody's kilt. I mean, just saying.
Yeah, there's usually not a lot underneath.
I can only imagine wanting to lift my own kilt.
So can we go into this? What is this officially called? Is this Tarot 6?
Wizard. It's Wizard self-titled.
Wizard yeah. This one?
Yes.
Yep.
Okay.
So let me tell you. So Sam spoke a little bit earlier about our influence of tarot. Every single release that we have made has a number assigned to it.
Okay.
So we had our original, like, first demo, which was... like what, 15 CDs,
all
hand drawn on,
right?
And we like wrote all this. It was just like really shitty CDR, like burned discs in jewel cases.
Sure.
That we wrote Tarot 1 on.
Okay.
So that was the demo 1, and then we had demo 2, which was Tarot 2, and then in Doomchild you can find it. It's kind of on one of the corners. It says Tarot 3, and
really?
That one. What was 4? 4 was. What was 4?
No.
Was it Ether? We never made a physical for Ether.
Okay.
They go on and on, but we kind of label our stuff as tarot, and we think of it as, the definition of a cult is hidden knowledge.
Right.
And we have hidden messages in each of our releases. And they all kind of represent elemental ideas or archetypal ideas that are implanted in the human subconscious.
Okay.
So,
now, I swear, because listening to that release, this release, this one right here.
Yeah, Doomchild.
Doomchild. I heard stuff in it that I swore. I was like, did I hear, like almost like a bong hit or something like that? I don't know. Like, was I imagining it? Was that real?
In one of the songs, I think it's Doomchild.
Doomchild.
Yeah, we have the line "Take the mighty toke," and so the three of us, we got this really nice omnidirectional microphone.
Right.
Randall set it up.
It was three different mics.
Oh, we had three different mics. We had three different mics for each of three different bongs. We had a bass bong, which was about 2 feet long.
Then we had our alto bong.
Alto, which was a straight tube, medium sized.
And then the soprano bong, which was a little like bubbler type of thing. A
little bing thing.
About 2 inches long. And the three of us, Jamie, Jalen and I, Lane couldn't smoke at the time.
We formed a trifecta around the three microphones.
Yeah, and we sat down and had this little chorus kind of harmony thing going with three different bongs.
We tuned them professionally ourselves with the precise amounts of water.
And if you listen real closely at the very end of that rip, you can hear somebody hacking. That is Sam running to the bathroom that is downstairs and promptly vomiting.
And if you listen closer.
Right at Take the Mighty Toke, we all tried to rip a whole bowl in one hit. I had the alto bong, and I ripped the whole bowl and promptly ejected my stomach contents. Into the porcelain bowl.
If you are a true audiophile, you will be able to hear the splashing.
Yeah, it's pretty gross.
It's included.
When we print it on vinyl, it's going to be like really deep in there. If you lay down in the dark and listen to it close, you will hear the vomit hitting the toilet bowl.
It's really kind of like got a lot of hidden meaning in it.
It's really artsy and deep.
You'll be able to tell what is in the vomit if you listen close enough.
You'll be able to tell what he ate 5 days prior, even.
So basically, you could tell more like if you need a spoon or a straw.
Definitely.
Yeah.
Probably, that was definitely a spoon, I'll tell you that right now.
Oh, good. Well, hey, hands up for big chunks. Good for you, brother. So at least I'm not crazy. So
no, you are not crazy. You did hear that.
Fuck, man. All right,
that is
good.
So on Spotify, it's our only explicit track simply because of that.
Okay. All right. Now, this release here, let's go. We talked a little about Drug or Not.
Yeah.
And I was talking to you earlier, ever since I picked this up last year, and I can't, you know, every once in a while, there's a song or a phrase or an idea or a thought that I will just say for randomly, for no apparent reason. I have no idea why it's catching my head the way it is, you know? And that's this next track, which I would, if you don't mind, sing it the way I would sing it around the house.
Yeah.
Yeah. I would love to. So, yeah. So it's called Great Mother Gaia. But I don't sing it like that. I sing Great Mother Gaia, and that's how it comes out. And I have no idea. I sing it in the car because I had it in the car for like a couple months. I sing it at the house. I don't know what it is about that track and why. And maybe it's the quickness of the track.
Very punk inspired.
Yeah, but
because where we come from, there's a lot of punk influence. Like Kalispell is definitely, the underground scene is definitely a punk town.
Really?
So we kind of, and for a lot of our initial shows that we would play at home at Old School Records, which is kind of like our home base for playing,
right?
The only bands we could play with were a bunch of punk bands. So there's a band called Bra back home, and really fucking good friends of ours. The bassist is Connor. He runs the record store, and I'm really good friends. We're all really good friends with all of them. But we play a lot of shows with them.
Right.
And, you know, we're the fucking Stoner Doom band. Not a whole lot of people back home smoke a lot of pot. So we decided, you know, let's do something that's, you know, hippie-esque, because it's our tribute to Earth.
Right.
And also to our the world in our story, and make it, you know, upbeat, you know, something that people can really mosh to and beat the shit out of each other.
We also thought that it would provide a very great contrast from the first track, Drug or Not.
Definitely.
Being a slow, heavy doom epic that's 14 minutes long, and then putting on like a 4-minute long punk inspired song immediately after it.
It's what I've mentioned on some other podcasts. It's that roller coaster where you definitely had that track in mind for the next one. So you could take a person on a ride.
We have been described by multiple people in reviews as schizophrenic sounding.
which we just absolutely take in and will completely accept as a compliment, because that is a compliment.
Yeah, I love that description.
So what can you say about King of Esbat?
Esbat.
I don't know how to say the names of any of our songs.
We don't know how to say it.
It was a song that came together just like riff after riff, and we had a concept of like the pre-main story in our story.
Right.
to have a king that ruled over the land who was basically, you can describe this better.
Yeah.
Is Esbat a real person, or is this something?
Esbat is it's an occultic gathering. It's a gathering of witches under a full moon.
Oh.
And they would do ritualistic shit. So
okay.
We decided, you know, throw that occult element in there as well.
Sure.
The story itself is about in our own little world that we made up, kind of Tolkien inspired type of stuff. There's a king who was usurped by our
Antagonist,
our adversary, the wizard.
The wizard.
Sure.
Spelt like which, the band.
Okay.
Which is what we named our band after. The wizard is the bad guy. He usurped the throne from the king in our story. And that story is about the king's kind of journey and his acceptance of his own death.
Okay.
It's kind of a shamanic experience where he comes across an Esbat of witches under a full moon. They give him a witch's brew, which he trips balls on, similar to psilocybin, LSD type
maybe
thing.
Maybe even like an ayahuasca?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah? Or DMT?
Yeah, very much.
Yeah.
And the last third of the song is an instrumental, which is his experience under the influence of this psychedelic as he experiences his death, essentially, and he ascends into another level of reality.
Wow.
And it's kind of our... We've got a whole made-up world that our whole second album takes place in, the first album as well. It's a whole fantasy world, and lots of influence from hermeticism, occultism, and, you know, basic Tolkien type of fantasy.
Oh, cool. All right. And what can you tell me about The Doomed?
So The Doomed is the plague which the wizard, our antagonist, spreads. We have a sort of a loose concept of where our magic comes from. It's a little different thing, but it's his way of enslaving the entire population of this earth.
Okay.
So the doom shall soon become us all is like the very last lines of the song, and it's the spread of this plague. It's the new plague that is a mind control. Like I can't really explain it too much other than that, but it's. On one hand, we play that song, you know, we like to give shout outs to all the people that came out because the song is about them, because we are the ones spreading the doom,
right?
You know, in that sense. But so we always dedicate it to all the people that showed out, all of our fans.
Oh, that's awesome. Now, okay, so the next few tracks, they go over what you were saying, over the different these different people. Are these based on you, or are they based on?
Loosely. Very
okay.
Loosely.
So then we'll just say. So we have dragon, warrior, wizard, phoenix, wrath,
okay. Wraith.
And then wizard.
And then wizard. So dragon. So we're still kind of in the midst of writing the backstories for this.
Right.
In terms of the story that we want to make and the comics or the graphic novel eventually that we want to put out, all that, you know, fancy bullshit that we don't have the money to do. But the dragon is a mute. And the reason that he's a mute is because his goal in life was to go out and slay every single dragon in the realm. And he accomplishes such.
Right.
He kills the elder dragon, which is his very last adversary. But in the elder dragon's death, he casts a curse on this warrior. Mm-hmm. And he can't speak.
Right.
Because if he does speak, he just shoots fire out of his mouth. So throughout the entirety of our little story, he doesn't talk ever. He has to communicate with gestures because, you know, sign language isn't a thing. So he kind of has to, like, gesture at everything and be very animated and, you know, being the vocalist. That pertains to me because I spit fire.
I spit hot fire.
Yeah, so that's generally what that's about. So there's the thrash and the death and the black metal parts at the very end of that.
Right.
We actually have a guest vocalist on that. Was Vincent on that one as well? So our friend that introduced Jamie and I, his name is Vincent Iacovone. He's been in a couple bands back home. He just was recently in a band called Fortress that just recently broke up not too long ago, about a couple months ago. But he was our special vocalist for the end of that, and he was the Elder Dragon.
Mm-hmm.
So there's a black metal part of the end, and that's like the whole fight between those two characters, between the dragon character and the Elder Dragon.
Oh, perfect.
Yeah.
All right, so then we go down to Warrior. Ah, there he is, the Warrior.
That's me. So,
now, before you start, are you each writing your own lyrics for that song, or is it a collaborative?
Collaborative. Yes and no.
Yeah?
Yes and no. I write a good handful of the stuff, but we always try to make it a collaborative thing. Like it is definitely a collaborative thing. It is a, you know, hive mind.
We all kind of have a part in the overall story, but sometimes the songs just kind of come to a couple people, riffs, lyrics, and everything. And a few people will get together and write a whole song, and the rest of us will come together with them and write our parts. So songs like Phoenix were written...
That one's my character, but it was written without me present at all.
We'll talk about that in a minute.
We will get there. Let's go with Warrior.
So, the way I remember it, it's been a little minute since we've sat down and seriously talked concept, just through the process of recording and going on tour and such. But the kind of concept I had for the Warrior was that it was just a guy in a village, you know, and the doomed come along, the plagued zombie-esque people come along, and there's a huge battle, and this guy is just trying to defend his village, right? And
right.
So he's kind of like a just farmer turned soldier or whatever. It's very loose right now, no specific details. And he gets mortally wounded, and he struggles his way into a clearing in a forest to where it's kind of like a mountainscape sort of type deal. And he dies either upon an altar or just on the ground there at the foot of this sort of rockscape. And his soul is transferred into a giant golem of stone that's just been laying dormant there. And he basically becomes the guardian of the forest. And covered in runes and stuff that glow with power when the being itself is alive, you know. And that's kind of what my tattoo is.
That one right there?
Yeah. It says Windir. It's like a warrior in Norse. And I just got this tattoo for the band, really.
Really?
And that's definitely what it represents.
That's you.
Yep.
That's you without question.
So each of the different characters does kind of represent our personality in a different way.
Okay.
And so eventually when we get down to writing the story and we can zoom in on the characters individually, we'll be able to capture some of their mannerisms. Like, I know probably one of the biggest things for me is I have a terrible memory, so that's probably going to come up a lot.
I'm sorry, I forgot. What were you saying?
Who were you?
What was that?
Where am I?
What happened? Huh?
But, and it's, and also they're, of course, the characters are based on the elements. So
yeah.
The warrior is the earth. And so a lot of their, I guess, fighting style or powers or whatever you want to call it is going to come from the earth, like being able to create just walls of stone from nothing or being able to harden their body or whatever, you know?
All right.
So it's all very loose right now, but...
Okay. Well, I want to go on to Wizard with one Z. Before I do, I just want to make sure I warn you ahead of time. At the end, I'm going to ask some questions that were asked by some previous bands. I have been really terrible at this because I have been forgetting, you know, after it gets late and I'm like, all right, good night. See you later. Yes. So you guys get two questions that are going to be asked of you.
Okay.
And if I can remember. And then if you have a question for the next band I interview, I would really appreciate that.
Okay.
And now we go into Wizard.
All right, so this track is spelled with one Z and an A, which is the correct English spelling of the word wizard.
Right.
However, because our band name is with two Zs and an E and we call it Wizard, we will be referring to this song as Wizard, as well as this character.
Okay.
So, the Wizard is an old, wizard who had studied for a long, long time and lived near the ocean. And he had an apprentice after many, many years of being a wizard and teaching other people to be wizards, had an apprentice who discovered, you know, the darker side of magic
right.
and things of the sort, who basically took all the teachings and knowledge that he had learned from the wizard and applied them poorly with bad decisions.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, very bad decisions.
And does that play off of you in real life, or?
Not exactly. In some ways, like we said, when we zoom into characters, we're going to do mannerisms and things like that.
Sure.
But when we're thinking about the wizard, we're thinking about casting spells, and I play the lead guitar, so I add a lot of the like little magical fairy dust on top, which is kind of where that fits in that
sprinkle
way.
Sprinkle a little of that dust. Well.
Exactly.
I like it.
Sprinkle some of that dust.
Yes. Hold on. I'll give you this one.
Here. In a way, the wizard, spelled as we spell our band name, a little bit weird. The antagonist, he represents kind of the negative aspects of anybody, including all of us. So, as the antagonist, the wizard was the apprentice of Jamie's character, the wizard.
With one Z and an A.
Yeah. And he kind of represents a bad side of humanity, an unenlightened person, and someone who makes bad decisions. And kind of our collective characters are the elements that move against bad decisions that humanity makes and the wrong ideas that people seem to hold that bring us all down as a species.
So I guess maybe a question would be, have you ever had a good time making a bad decision?
Oh, well, of course, every single night of tour. Oh,
there you have it.
Let's get into a track by the band Marijana, spelled Marijannah. And the name of the track is called Snake Charmer. Check this out.
Yeah.
DoomTomb Podcast@gmail.com is how to reach us. We're also on social media at DoomTomb Podcast. You can find us and just send me a link, send me a line, say hello. Tell me what's going on in the scene in your area. I'd be really interested to know. And tell me what you want to hear. I have a few interviews that I have been doing over Skype and a few other avenues. So I don't always do the live interviews. If somebody wants something that they'd rather be over the phone, hey, I'm down. So just let me know. Let me know if somebody you know is interested. Also, next episode will be part two, obviously, of the band Wizard. Can't wait for that. And I have a whole bunch of other people coming up. The band Worshipper, Pink Cocoon, Via Vengeance, the band Source. There's going to be so much coming up. I might have to put the Source interview a little bit earlier because they're going out on tour, I think starting next week. So look forward to that. Check them out. It's spelled S-O-R-X-E. And until that time, the next time, the meantime, the in-between time, enjoy yourself. Keep going to the shows. Buy some band merch every once in a while. And don't forget to stay heavy.